of reaction.
Yes.
And Nigerians now introduce detergent to speed up the fermentation rate in making garri. Mm. How do you use detergent, you know, to do such? These are current practice in this part of the world, you know. I don't know. I'm still saying that whoever started this kind of thing, what led them to it, they deserve an award, sort of, you know. But I used to tell my students that when you do this kind of thing, you are killing yourself gradually. This even go beyond genetics. You know, you accumulate this kind of thing, they can cause immediate damage in the system. The liver is there to detoxify. And when the liver keeps on detoxifying, it gets to a level that it may not be able to cope with what is supposed to detoxify in the body. And the liver itself gets damaged, you know. These are some of the root causes of some of the problems we are having, you know. And if you permit me,
yes.
The third aspect of that is also on the use of herbs. You know, I also...
That was exactly where I was going, because you said here that herbs contain mitodepressive capacity.
Yeah.
And you are trying to tell the federal government that something could still be done to help us with this issue of herbs.
Which is true. When I was in India, there was a time I was having runny nose. I was having catarrh, water coming out of my nose. And I got to the lab that day. I told the PhD students I was working with that they should show me a chemist or a pharmacist where I could buy vitamin C. And they said, what do you need it for? And I told them that, look at my nose, it's running. They said, okay, just hold on. Let's get on to break time. And at break time, they took me to the nearest market. There was this type of fruit. I don't want to mention the name here, you know. We bought three. They said, I should take one that day. Fruit. One small fruit.
Okay.
You know, that I should take one that day, one the other day, and the other the third day. That they were so sure the nose would dry. And lo and behold, this was what happened. The nose dried. You see, two things struck me. One, that I used that fruit and it works. Two, that it was the PhD student that told me. I saw their level of education, their level of understanding of plants in the environment. Of course, they told me several other things when we got to the market. They showed me many things. If you eat this, you feel like this. If you eat this, you feel like that, and so on like that, you know, which is missing in this part of the world. Now, back to where I am now. I know Ewuro. I know some plants here, but I'm not sure the ones that I know that my children knows them. This is the truth. You know, I'm just true confession,
yes,
which is what happens in our society. And here we are, everywhere you have plants. From what we have done, apart from other studies that my colleagues are conducting in other departments, we know that plants have medicinal value.
Yes.
Of interest to us, which I stumbled on accidentally with a master student, was that some of these plants have anti-proliferative potential.
Meaning?
A plant that have anti-proliferative potential means it has the capacity to be able to reduce cell division. And such kind of plant means it may have potential to be able to assist in treating cancer cell. Because cancer is an abnormal environment. The cell keeps on dividing and dividing till the kingdom come. There is no regulation, you know. We have tried this severally. We are starting something very soon again. I mean, having seen this, I was of the opinion that I think this is a potential that I think we should have done in this kind of environment. You put in a lot of money, you know, to do a lot of work on that so as to be able to see what we can take out of that to help the society. That's what happens in India. That's what happens in China and several parts of the world, you know. The other aspect which I wanted to mention the other time, which also has to do with drugs, because it was in the process of working with this agent that we got to know this. Issue of contraindication may also set in this society. You know, somebody who have diabetes, for example, wakes up or has been to the hospital and they have prescribed, take this drug at 7 a.m. in the morning, take another one at 7 p.m. in the evening, and that person wakes up in the morning, he takes that drug, 30 minutes after that, he mixes some concoctions together and takes that again. Or maybe take the concoction before taking the drug. You see, the drug you have taken, yes, you know the quantity, 500 milligrams of this. But The concoction you are drinking later on, 1 cup, 2 cups, 3 cups, or 5 cups, or boil, let it be cold a bit, then you take 1 cup. You are not sure of what is there. You are not sure of the quantity you took in the morning and the quantity you are taking the night. We are looking at a case whereby between synthetic drugs and herb extract, we want to try and see the kind of contraindication that probably comes in. Of course, there are studies that are suggesting that, but we may need to do more on that. And it's also something that people need to look at. Okay. They have to be careful in this society.
In all of this, Prof, as we wind down on the program this morning, in all of this now, let's talk about the role of the stakeholders. And where we mean stakeholders, the number one stakeholder definitely is the government. What is the role of the government and other stakeholders like you and others in this aspect that we have talking about in terms of the proper disposal of wastes and then these issues of herbs, self-medication and everything?
It's a bit complex, but let me try. You know, when you talk of stakeholders, first and foremost, I believe government has to do their own. As regards where I work, government needs to put money into research. That is not what we have now, is nothing to write home about. So you can't really talk of big time findings with what government puts into research in this part of the world. They need to invest a lot on that. Two, I also know that there are policies in this country. We do a lot of work, we write a lot of papers for government, white papers and so on like that. But the implementation aspect is faulty. For example, I still find it difficult to understand the way we manage waste in Ibadan, for example. I have never seen it anywhere where the mode of waste dumping is to put in the middle of the road. I have not, you know, some things are just strange.
Which the government is fighting aggressively, but
as they are fighting it aggressively, individuals also have to be disciplined. Because it's, we were discussing something, you know, this last week. We were talking about government, and somebody said, if you talk about government, you are the government. If you do it right in your own corner, I do it right in my own corner, he does it right in his own corner, then everything will be right up there. Because most times we talk about government, we talk about the leaders, we don't talk about the followership. It's in my, where I live, I used to complain that the drainage system there, are you waiting for the state governor to come and clear that drainage for you?
For you?
Because the blockage of drainage is as a result of your own activity. Which is what you see on a daily basis. So we need this synergism. We need high level of discipline.
Maybe the government has not been driving it properly in terms of orientation and
right
education.
Right from the top, high level of discipline, orientation, education, follow-ups. You know, not that you do something today, then you leave it. No. Follow ups to be able to sure that things are being done the way it's supposed to
be. Are we ever going to get to that level in this country? Does it look to you that we will get there?
For me, it's one of the reasons why I'm still in Nigeria. Otherwise, I would have left long ago. Because I believe that, no, we can get it right.
Okay.
So we only I need to get it right myself. You should get it right yourself. The next man should get it right. I believe everything will be fine in the country.
We hope to get there, Prof. But just before we draw the curtain on the program, let's talk about one niggling issue that has been there as far as the university system is concerned. And that is this issue of strike, 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 and strike. As we speak, I'm sure you are in a 2-week warning strike.
Yeah, you got it right, warning strike.
And we all know the issues, Prof. Are you worried about these issues?
Of course I'm worried. I've been a veteran of several strikes, right from, when was that, 1992 or so, as a student, then as a staff. I'm worried, but the truth of the matter is that we have to struggle for our right. In this country, if you don't struggle, if you don't make noise, you won't get anything. The university system, you know, is a place where you don't just take any decision anyhow on their affairs. No, we visit other places outside this place, outside Nigeria. We know the way research institutions, the way universities are run. We know the way they are funded. You know, it's a, I don't want to use the word seclusion, but we are special people because every now and then a university professor, a university PhD holder is working. Even if he's at home, he's busy thinking either designing study or writing paper or supervising something. We work almost 24/7. You know, when you do that kind of thing, you need an enabling environment. What now happens if I don't even have enough money to eat, not to talk of sending my children to school, not to now talk of what I need to work in the lab?
Okay.
These are issues.
Issues.
You know.
Of course we know. But there's also one issue that seems a bit controversial here, and that's the issue of the Integrated Payroll and Personnel Information System, the IPPIS issue, Prof.
Mm.
A lot of people think that you, the members of us, who are actually do not want to understand. How do you tell your employer your mode of payment?
I do not agree with that last sentence.
Okay.
That how do you tell your employer?
That's impression out there.
I know that is impression. I've read it severally. But it also comes from what I was discussing earlier on. We are not civil servants.
Hmm.
We're not. You don't just treat us anyhow. We have been in discussion with governments for long on how universities should be run. You don't just wake up one day and say, this is what I want to be used in paying you, without taking into consideration our peculiarities. We know what is going on now. Those that are using IPPIE, you know, this is something we can be on for the next 1 hour again. We know what is going on.
Now you have proposed the University Transparency and Accountability Solution. How is that going to make any difference?
Well, if they take it, if there is genuineness,
yes,
then I think we're on the way to solving the problem. According to them, IPPIE is to avoid corruption also in the university system.
Mm.
We know that the system they are talking about is also corrupt.
Mm.
Let's just leave it like that.
Mm.
We have proposed something for them, which we know can work. Then, I want also to tell you something. How do you, in a country where you have intellectuals, where you have varsity people that are doing research day in and out, that you cannot make use of them to design this kind of thing, and you now have to go and sort out consultants? So it's a big question mark on that, you know.
I must sincerely thank you, Prof, for coming on the program this morning. I'm talking about Professor Adekunle Bakare, the head Department of Zoology, University of Ibadan. Of course, he held his inaugural lecture recently on environmental xenobiotics and biological spiral staircase, for good or for ill. And it's as a result of the offshoot of this lecture that we have been talking this morning. We thank you for coming, Prof.
Thank you very much.
Thanks so much. And to you, our esteemed listener, I want to say a very big thank you for always being there for us. Let me also say thank you to the producer of this program, Tunde Tiamu, and of course, my in-house producer here, the man who has been doing justice to the buttons and everything in the studio, talking about Babafemi Obidehi. And my name is Pius Nsabe. Let's do this again next Saturday. Thank you for being there. Have a lovely weekend, and don't forget to continue to be a good citizen of this beautiful country. May God bless the Federal Republic of Nigeria.
Amen.